Bienvenidos a la noche cósmica de la oveja eléctrica, aquí en Canal 22, en donde vamos a conversar sobre un nuevo enfoque para desarrollar medicamentos contra el COVID-19. En la emisión anterior, conversamos con el profesor Gideon Schreiber, líder de un equipo de científicos en el Instituto Weizmann, que está elaborando un supertapón biomolecular para cerrarle la entrada al virus. Esto es clave para complementar la estrategia de las maravillosas vacunas que ya se han desarrollado en el combate contra la pandemia. En la segunda y última parte de esta entrevista, el profesor Schreiber nos habla de la evolución in vitro del coronavirus. El término in vitro se refiere a una técnica para realizar un determinado experimento en un tubo de ensayo o generalmente en un ambiente controlado fuera de un organismo vivo. Este enfoque permite una interesante manera de entender cómo se dan las variantes del COVID-19 y por qué es tan importante desarrollar medicamentos como el que está investigando el profesor Schreiber, que pueden bloquear la entrada a todo tipo de variantes. Two questions. You have developed then a technique of vitro evolution that mimics the process of natural selection, but at a much faster pace. What did you find in this way that it correlates with what happens with in reality, with the variants of the virus?
This is a very good question, because what we found amazingly is that already at the first step of our in vitro evolution, again, that's a method where we make a lot of mutations and we select for those that bind stronger. And what did we find? Already at the first round of selection, we found exactly the mutations that are seen, and they were selected out. So the mutations that were seen in the alpha variant, so the alpha variant which originated in Great Britain, the 501Y, so we selected that one out, so it binds tighter, we selected it. We selected the beta and the gamma variants. The beta and gamma variants are the variants that were found in Brazil initially, and the other one in South Africa. Again, these bind even tighter, and they also have kind of some immune evasion. While the alpha is no immune evasion, they do have immune evasion. And we actually got all these variants that the virus developed during infection of many millions of people. The virus developed, and which was the direction that the natural virus developed, the same direction that we found that we also developed it, but in the test tube for better binding. In other words, one of the directions that the virus is developing or has been developing was for better binding. In this case, the alpha, the beta, and the gamma variants, which basically up to kind of few months ago were dominant. The alpha went everywhere, and then the beta and gamma luckily didn't go anywhere. And the reason is not that they weren't so infectious, because they were, because if you look in Brazil, or if you look in South Africa, then you saw that the beta and gamma actually overtook the other variants, both in Brazil and in South Africa, respectively. But there isn't so much trouble out from Brazil and South Africa like from the UK. So the alpha variant really spread very strong everywhere, but the beta and gamma were more restricted in the spread, because the amount of travel out from Brazil and South Africa is unproportionately so much smaller, and you need international travel for these variants to spread. Now, of course, now we have the Delta variant, which originated in India and in other places, and there's a different problem, because the Delta variant has some immune evasion with it. It's also binding tighter to some extent, but especially it knows to evade part of the immune system so that it can infect better, and also it produces more viral particles. And therefore, it's so much more infectious than the original one. So the virus has more than one trick. So what we found was the trick that it used for the alpha, beta, and gamma variant The Delta variant is another trick that it's using. In the future, definitely we'll see more tricks that the virus can use, but I think the two main avenues that the virus will be using also in future variants will be immune evasion and tighter binding. Now, immune evasion is also a problem, because if you think about vaccines, then if you have immune evasion, you can also decrease the efficiency of the vaccine, because the vaccine was not done against either of these variants, but against the original one. Now, of course, the companies that make the vaccines know this. So then they make new vaccines that will include also better resistance for the variants. The problem is that until they prepare the better resistant vaccine, there is a new variant coming out. So the variants are changing quite rapidly. And I don't have to tell you that in the news, kind of every few days, we hear about another variant. Many of them are not really that, I would say, important and not make a big difference. We heard a lot in South America. We saw a lot of the Lambda variant coming up, but I think that the Delta definitely is the more problematic one, and it doesn't seem that the Lambda is out-competing anything that we have right now. At least that's what it looks like. But variants are changing, the virus is evolving, and the virus also still has a very, very long...
Los cambios y variantes del COVID-19 son inevitables. De ahí la importancia de estudiar su posible evolución in vitro para prever los escenarios que pueden ocurrir y conocer sus procesos de expresión. Esto siempre será fundamental. De este interesante estudio y de la necesidad de medicamentos contra todo tipo de variantes, conversaremos después del corte con Gideon Scheiber, destacado investigador del Instituto Weizmann. En un parpadeo cósmico, volvemos a la oveja eléctrica. Como de rayo con tintes verdes y dorados que tratan de iluminar, mediante el desarrollo del conocimiento, los escenarios que nos permiten contrarrestar la pandemia, estamos de regreso en la noche cósmica de la oveja eléctrica, aquí en Canal 22. Estamos conversando con Gideon Scheiber, un destacado investigador del Instituto Weizmann en Israel, sobre el proceso de evolución de los virus, de sus variantes, que se pueden estudiar in vitro y que subraya la necesidad de nuevos enfoques para combatir al COVID-19. El desarrollo de vacunas en tan breve tiempo ha sido uno de los grandes logros de la ciencia contemporánea. Para ello, es clave entender lo más profundamente posible cómo se desarrollan y expresan los virus, cómo es que cambian en el curso del tiempo. En este contexto, se puede apreciar cómo, además de las vacunas, requerimos medicamentos para tapar la entrada a futuras variantes. Así, el profesor Scheiber y su equipo están elaborando un supertapón biomolecular mediante ingeniería de proteínas que impide la entrada del virus en un receptor celular llamado ACE2. Se trata de un importante enfoque ante un virus en evolución.
So in another study that we did, we looked at the evolution of the virus. Where is it evolving? And what one can see very clearly is that the virus is evolving in the most normal way. So first of all, it takes certain kind of amino acids. Amino acids are the blocks that build the protein. So it takes a mutator, certain types of amino acids that are most easily approachable. And then in a second step of evolution, it can probe additional amino acids. And this is the step that we are now. So if until, let's say, 6 months ago, the virus only probed a certain set of amino acids, now it's already better probing more amino acids. But the different amino acids coming together, so very often, you can have one amino acid that doesn't have an advantage, a second amino acid that doesn't have an advantage. But if you have both of the mutations together, then you can get the big advantage of having both of them. So this takes longer time, because the chance of getting both of them together is like, you know, throwing the dice. To get, let's say, a six in a dice, you have some chance with 1, 2, 6. But to get 2 sixes in the dice, of course, the chance is much, much lower. Okay. So in this sense, to get kind of multiple amino acids to change, in order to get an advantage, as long as there's no advantage for either of them separately, this takes longer. And this is something that slowly comes up. So the virus has a long way that potentially it goes. Now, in our in vitro evolution, we got even much, much higher binding than the virus ever got. And the virus also won't go there because nobody says that infinitely strong binding gives an advantage to the virus. There are many things that are important for the virus. So somewhat stronger binding gave an advantage, but nobody says that even stronger binding would give even a bigger advantage. Okay, so there are kind of multiple rules to it, and we don't understand all of it. I cannot say, because if we would understand all of them, we could easily say where the virus is going. Everybody is right now guessing, and everybody kind of tries to understand, okay, where is the virus going next? Okay, so we are not sure.
That's why it's so important, the new angle and the new approach you are taking. But one thing that is very important also is what new angles are being opened by the approach of your research, not just to fight COVID-19, but other future viral problems.
So I would say two things. So one of them, okay, this goes back to what we did here. Because we block the entry ports, ACE2, it's good against the different variants. So as I said, you have different variants, and then if you have now neutralizing antibodies to the virus, then if you get a variant, it may overcome the neutralizing antibodies. But because we block the entry port, even if the virus is changing, it doesn't change. It still needs the same entry port because else it's not the same virus. So all these kind of viruses need the same entry port. So we are blocking all the viruses of the same family from going into this entry port. Now this can be, of course, generally applied because to do in vitro evolution is very rapid. To do it took us maybe 2 months. Most of the time is spent on other things, not on this, on all the cellular assays and so on. But just now to evolve proteins, to be super tight binders is something rapid. So a different virus, you can do the same approach. You can try and say, okay, let's evolve something that will be a super tight binder to the entry port. This way we will not have a problem with any variant. And then we can basically eliminate or stop the disease from spreading. Okay, so I would say that this could be a general approach with the strengths of the protein engineering methods that are now available. And this takes relative short time. Of course, the problem is that the evolution of the cork takes a short time. But from there to go and to do the preclinical studies and eventually the clinical studies, this takes a long time. And then comes the question, how can you shorten this part?
El enfoque del profesor Schreiber del Instituto Weizmann va más allá de los problemas de futuras variantes de los virus. ¿Cómo acelerar el proceso de desarrollo de un medicamento que le tapa la entrada al COVID-19? De ello conversaremos después del corte. Volvemos a la oveja eléctrica después de un parpadeo electrónico. De rayo con tintes verdes y dorados que nos permite ver cómo podemos acelerar el desarrollo de nuevos medicamentos, estamos de regreso en la noche cósmica de la oveja eléctrica aquí en Canal 22. En la serie Star Trek se utiliza el concepto de warp speed, una velocidad asombrosa más allá de la luz, para que las naves espaciales puedan atravesar el cosmos y llegar a sus metas que parecían imposibles. Esta metáfora sirvió de inspiración para que en el desarrollo de las vacunas también se aplicara una operación denominada Warp Speed. Así es como la ciencia obtuvo vacunas eficientes y confiables en un tiempo récord, en menos de un año. Para elaborar medicamentos contra el COVID-19 que cierren la puerta de entrada a cualquier variante, también se requiere una operación Warp Speed. De ello conversaremos con el destacado profesor Gideon Schreiber del Instituto Weizmann en Israel, quien encabeza una investigación de punta para taparle la entrada al COVID-19. How this research can be accelerated. As you know, in terms of vaccines, it was developed the Operation Warp Speed. What can we do so we have available this new approach very soon to all the people?
So I would say warp speed for this kind of approach would really make a difference, because if you would, in parallel, if you would have a company that would invest money and the government that will support the company for investing money, and you get rapid human experiments, then you can much faster make new drugs. Now, today, the point is that most drug companies, because of the rapid vaccine development, said, you know, to develop a new drug, so what people used and tried were existing drugs. And basically all the pharmacy of existing drugs was used and tried against COVID-19, and most of them without too much success. There is success, so for example, steroids help and some other drugs help, but none of them really was a good drug against the COVID-19, as we know. But this is an easy approach because all these drugs have already approved to be used on humans, so a doctor can by himself even do it without a big experiment. And doctors in all everywhere in the clinic actually did it. So they just say, okay, I have a drug that is approved already, let's try it. So this has been done. New drug, this is a long development. But it can really be shortened if you say, okay, we will support, the governments will support it, and companies will support these new drugs, and then the path in general for new drugs could be really, really shortened from the relative very long time it takes now to a much, much shorter time of even a few months. Now, because the vaccine development was so rapid and seemingly successful, companies said, and also governments, why develop a drug if you have now a vaccine? We don't need the drug anymore. We vaccinate the people. Now we see that we are a year and a half after. We are 8 months after vaccines are available, and we are still drowning in the COVID-19. So it seems that only to put all your money on vaccines may not be the right way. Maybe you should put money, of course, on vaccines, but also on drugs, because the long-term solution definitely should involve also drugs, and here we need new drugs. So I think this is a change of thinking that comes now because we see the problem that it's not sufficient to have only vaccine.
What is your expectative of having this new drug available for everybody? When we could use this aerosol spray to fight COVID-19? I know it's not easy question, but people have expectations, yes.
Yes, but I can say that in the coming weeks, and I don't want to give the exact time, we are going to do the primate experiments, which are very crucial. So there we have to show that it will work also in the primate model, not only in the hamster model. If it will work, as we hope it will, in the primate model, then the way from there to clinical studies should be relatively very short. Again, for this, you need an infrastructure of production of the drug, but we know how to produce it. So this shouldn't be that long. So totally in theory, by the end of the year, it should be in clinical trials. But I don't know. This is not, you know, for this, you need already much larger investments of funds. You need somebody who is ready to put millions in this kind of experiments, because then they really start. Clinical studies are very expensive. So, as I said, the monkey experiments, if they will work as we hope, then the way to the clinic should be relatively fast.
You know, you were doing this kind of research for curiosity, like in Weizmann Institute, you always do. And now it begins to pay off. So it's very, very, very rewarding. the work you're doing?
Many institutes still believe that they should do practical research. But then you look which research actually really brings the best reward, the biggest reward, and it's always the basic research. The basic research, you give the scientists the freedom to go their way into basic research, and then you really get the big reward.
And this gives us really some rays of light and hope. Professor Gideon Shriver, thank you very much for your presence in Channel 22 in Mexico and for sharing your knowledge so generously with our Mexican audience. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Pleasure. Thank you.
Pues ahí están los frutos del deseo de entender, de la investigación básica de la ciencia, que es motor de transformaciones, de avances médicos que alivian el sufrimiento en nuestra sociedad. Un honor tener la presencia del profesor Gideon Shriver, quien generosamente comparte con el auditorio mexicano investigaciones de vanguardia que abren nuevos horizontes y posibilidades de medicamentos para enfrentar la pandemia con todo el arsenal con el que cuenta la ciencia. Estos granitos de arena son los que ayudan, los que contribuyen a crear una sociedad de imaginación y conocimiento como la que necesitamos ante los retos del siglo XXI. ¿Y qué mejor que ver en movimiento esa imaginación de la ciencia y la tecnología que nos abre los ojos con belleza y esperanza que en la sección de nuestra querida compañera Miriam Moscona? Pues querida Miriam, cuando estamos en este escenario, realmente no sabemos si estamos dentro de una célula o en un paisaje cósmico.
¿Hora de cuál fumamos, mi Pepe? Mira, como suele ocurrir en la ciencia, hoy vamos a ver unas imágenes que de verdad más parece un collage hecho de diversos materiales, incluso de materiales así reciclados de la basura o de otras cosas, que imágenes fotográficas con el rigor de la ciencia. Y estas imágenes hablan de algo de lo que tú y yo estamos hechos.
Esta composición abstracta y geométrica a la vez parece más el mapa de una ciudad futurista que una célula humana. Se trata de la imagen más detallada de una célula humana hasta la fecha, obtenida de la radiografía, de la resonancia magnética nuclear y de la microscopia crioelectrónica. Y, en efecto, parece producto de una alucinación con psicotrópicos, pero se trata de la unidad más pequeña que puede vivir por sí sola y que forma a todos los organismos vivos y a los tejidos del cuerpo. Que no le digan, que no le cuenten. Esta imagen que parecería un huevo de fantasía en un nido vegetal color naranja es, o más bien son, microtúbulos dentro de una célula. Y el huevo en color azul es nada más y nada menos que su núcleo. Esta increíble imagen de Jackson Kirk fue reconocida en la Nikon Small World 2020 y se obtuvo mediante un microscopio confocal. ¿Cuánto pesa una célula humana? ¿Hay celulitas y celulotas? En época reciente, investigadores suizos dieron a conocer esta pequeña balanza en voladizo diseñada para detectar las más mínimas fluctuaciones en la masa de una célula viva. Con estas tres imágenes, podemos decir que la oveja eléctrica, nuestra ovejita, no necesita psicotrópicos para alucinar.
Y bueno, llegamos así al final de esta temporada de la oveja eléctrica, con el tono de la esperanza genuina que nos abre el bien común de la investigación científica. Nuestro agradecimiento más profundo al público que nos acompaña y al gran equipo de trabajo comandado por mi entrañable amigo Froilán López Lavín, que realiza esta producción con un compromiso a pruebas de las circunstancias vividas en la pandemia. Será un gran gusto encontrarnos alrededor del fuego electromagnético de la tribu en la próxima temporada de La Oveja Eléctrica, y nos vamos con un toque de humor, ironía y gracia con los cantos cuánticos de nuestro querido Fernando Rivera Calderón. Pues querido Fernando Rivera Calderón, fíjate que el día de hoy hemos estado hablando de una técnica muy interesante de evolución in vitro, que permite estudiar las diferentes formas en que puede evolucionar un virus, las diferentes variantes que puede tener, para entenderlo y así también realizar medicamentos. Esto trae verdaderamente un horizonte de esperanza.
Wow, sí, sí, sí. Se me llena el cuerpo de esperanza, Pepe. Sí, es un tema muy interesante. Siempre todo el tema in vitro, ¿no? Como te acuerdas de ese boxeador que ganaba todas sus peleas, que estaba in vitro. Y yo por eso compuse una canción. La he pensado toda la semana para estar a la altura del tema, ¿no?
Que es a como ver, un tema a ver, complejo. A ver.
Dice más o menos así. Esta canción es sobre la evolución. In vitro.
In vitro.
In vitro.
In vitro.
Esta canción incluye una reflexión. In vitro.
In vitro.
In vitro. Porque si ganas todas las peleas, serás un boxeador. In vitro.
Oye, mi querido, me parece que no compusiste esa canción,
Pepe,
hasta
no pude
este
hacer
momento.
La tarea esta semana, discúlpame.
Bueno, pero hagamos una tarea in vitro ahorita.
Sí, es que me la pasé in vitro con unos cuates, echándome unas... Bueno, luego les platico, amigos, sigamos in vitro.
Claro, claro.
Esta canción es sobre la evolución in vitro. Te invito a unos tragos.
Lo más importante al final del día es que nos trae esperanza estas posibilidades que nos abre la ciencia.
Así es.
Y más que in vitro.